Designed to endure the roadless marshes and forests of northern Sweden, the CV90 is a family of Swedish-made tracked combat vehicles available in multiple variants. It is one of the most successful infantry fighting vehicles in recent history from an export point of view, with 7 European nations operating derivatives of the CV90, namely Denmark, Estonia, Finland, the Netherlands, Norway, which made the first export order in 1994, Switzerland, and Sweden. 1,280 vehicles from the CV90 family have been sold thus far, and 4.5 million hours worth of research and development have been invested as a base in the most recent version, the CV90 Mark IV. Welcome to another Tank Encyclopedia voiced article. I'm your host, Tony, and today I'll be guiding you through the development history of the CV90. Thank you to those who have already subscribed and to those of you who haven't. Hit the subscribe button below. I wouldn't want you missing out on any of our new videos. If you'd like to contribute more directly, you can join the ranks of our channel's members or make a donation on PayPal or Patreon. It helps us to keep you informed on the latest and greatest developments in the armored sphere. The Swedish Defense Resolution of 1977 can be pointed at as the starting point of the development of the CV90 family, with studies on new military vehicles carried out by Svantesson AB, a shared company owned by Hägglunds and Bofors. Operations in the deep snow and marshlands of northern Sweden was a priority, and the opinion of the time, based on the relatively poor mobility of the Centurion and S-Tank, deemed this as an impossible task. This opinion was changed, however, when deliveries of the 16.3-ton IKV-91, a Swedish-made light tank, met the previously stated operational requirement, thus setting the base for mobility as equal to or better than the IKV-91. Studies then shifted focus in the early 80s to vehicles that could both penetrate the sides of contemporary tanks and carry a rifle squad of 8 soldiers, with a study considering an armament range between 25 and 60 mm. The Bofors 40mm and 57mm high-pressure anti-aircraft guns were given a special focus as a threat scenario also included helicopters and low-flying aircraft. The design study eventually surpassed its 20-ton limit as the weight and volume of the 40mm two-man turret being similar to that of the IKV-91 on top of the requirement to carry 8 soldiers led to an inevitable increase in vehicle weight. Ground pressure increases in proportion to vehicle weight, and ground pressure is a dominant factor in vehicle mobility as it can lead to motion resistance through sinkage. This led to the possibility that the vehicles could have a mobility lower than that of the IKV-91. Overlapping road wheels were considered as a solution to maintain high mobility, and tests were conducted on UDES-08 that was converted from a PVV-302 APC. So the CV90 family in the end did not adopt this feature. The results of this test were presented at the 1981 ISTVS, International Society for Terrain Vehicle Systems, international conference by Alfons Falk, who would be contacted afterwards by Professor J.Y. Wong, a Terra mechanic scientist who had recently developed a theoretical mobility model for the sinkage and motion resistance of tracked vehicles in soft soils, including snow. This meeting was the start of a 2-year period of mobility simulations, with the first set done with the IKV-91 in deep snow to see if the results were realistic. The results from the simulations laid the base for the CV90's mobility elements, and Alfons Falk would later receive the Bekkereke Redfirth Award during the 2002 ISTVS International Conference as an acknowledgement of the CV90's outstanding mobility, becoming the very first person to receive the award. During the final studies in the early 1980s, the CV90 gradually evolved into its present design, and it was decided that it should be a vehicle family based on one chassis, with design priority placed on the CV90-40 Infantry Fighting Vehicle (IFV), designated as the STRF-9040. Other variants included the EPPV-90, a forward observation vehicle, the STRIPPV-90, a combat command and control vehicle, the LVKV-90, an anti-aircraft vehicle, and the BGPV-90, an armored recovery vehicle. The creation of a large roll volume that lacked any vital vehicle system was the overarching goal, and as the vehicle's main components were retained from the base vehicle, designers could focus on each variant's role-specific requirements. 2 rigs were ordered in 1984 by the Swedish Defense Material Administration, FMV. one for mobility trials, built by Haglunds to investigate whether the design's mobility was equal to or better than the IKV-91, and another for weapon test built by Bofors to investigate the behavior of a turret with an upside-down 40mm gun and the vehicle's response while firing an 8-round salvo. Before we get into the results, here's a quick message from our sponsor, GSJJ. GSJJ is one of the best challenge coin makers. These are custom metal coins that come in various shapes, size, and colors, traditionally awarded for those that overcome challenges and hardships. With GSJJ, you can order coins designed with a template, or you can get your own design turned into metal. Nowadays, they are most notable in law enforcement and the military. There are many kinds being used, including Army, Navy, Air Force, and Marine Corps. Examples of this include a Marine Corps challenge coin issued for participation in Operation Freedom Sentinel in Afghanistan, or a challenge coin issued to the 3/157th Field Artillery Battalion of the 157th Field Artillery Regiment for regimental excellence, both of which you could get through GSJJ. Or you could also use their online, easy-to-use design system, in which you can create your own challenge coin using their custom editor. There is no limit to how much you can LARP with these coins. GSJJ offers free shipping, no minimum order quantity, and crucially, cheap prices. You can get coins that cost as low as $1.41 per coin. They also make patches, ornaments, wristbands, medals, and more. You can check out more of what they do in their website linked in the description below. Thanks to GSJJ for sponsoring this video. Now let's get back to your regularly scheduled program. Results from both tests were promising, with the mobility test showing that the requirements could be met and that the vehicle's mobility was increased significantly with the use of the rig's active track tension system. Results from the weapons test showed that the upside-down mounting was feasible, together with a powered ammunition feed from below. While firing an 8-round salvo, the last round was 10m above target at a distance of 1,000m. There was no requirement in 1984 to fire on the move, and the test led to the suspension system of the CV90-40A, where road wheel stations 1, 2, 6, and 7 are locked during firing. Alongside the rigs, a full-scale mock-up was created to ensure that the vehicle had a high volume efficiency, which can be defined as the vehicle being big on the inside and small on the outside. The Swedish Armour School PS also conducted mock-up trials of different seating positions, in which they found out that to obtain the required low height, the best seating position was with the soldiers facing each other, with the CV90-40A having 4 seats on each side. The sponsons on each side of the better protected central fighting compartment were less protected in order to improve on weight efficiency. All these design features resulted in the CV90 weighing 3 tons lighter than similar vehicles with the same requirements. In 1985, full development on the CV90 would commence, carried out by HB Utveckling AB, with Haglunds and Bofors being responsible for the chassis and turret respectively. One exception was the 9025 turret, which originated from a firepower upgrade program for the PPV-302 APC. All 5 of the prototypes shared the same hull and were used to improve on reliability during testing, an extremely difficult task as a tenfold improvement was required when compared to the IKV-91. 4 of the prototypes had the same clutch brake steering system as the IKV-91, while the 5th had the X300, a transmission system used in the British Warrior IFV. As the X300 was 100mm shorter and 35mm higher than the clutch brake alternative, the engine hatch on the 5th prototype had to be raised. The 3-man CV90-25 turret was armed with a Bushmaster 25mm chain gun and shared the same basic system as the 1-man 25mm turret intended for the PPV-302 APC upgrade. The turret also had a smaller diameter, as the 25mm chain gun was smaller than the 40mm gun, and an adapter ring had to be used to allow for installation on the hull. The 5th prototype was fitted with this turret and would serve as a base for CV90-30, an export version bound for Norway. 3 prototypes would be designated for trials with different configurations of the 40mm CV90-40 turret intended to evaluate important subsystems such as gun control, sights, and machine gun mounts, and the 4th prototype had an air defense variant of the 40mm turret. The maturation process of a new vehicle is often underestimated, and the CV90 family underwent a lengthy test period. The 10-fold reliability requirement was only met towards the end of the testing, with important factors such as the replacement of the clutch brake system with the X300 transmission and the adoption of the M2 Bradley's tracks and road wheels after evaluations contributing to the CV90's reliability growth. During testing, the vehicles were crewed by conscripts, with the exception of one driven by professional test drivers from Higlands, and it was observed that the vehicle was driven at twice the average speed but only suffered from half of the expected number of failures, another testament of the CV90's outstanding reliability. Several reviews were conducted by a number of bodies, with Swedish Army workshops gradually improving the CV90's maintainability through multiple reviews, while a reference group known as the Four Majors focused on ensuring that the vehicle met the user's demand for fighting ability. This resulted in design changes to the CV90 that improved user experience. Recently, the CV90 family has undergone a life extension program, so almost none of the upgrades were related to the extension or availability of the vehicle's main automotive components. And with that, we come to the end of another Tank Encyclopedia voiced article. Thank you for watching, and if you think the CV90s are the best of the best when it comes to infantry fighting vehicles, leave a comment below. Consider subscribing if you haven't already. And until next time, keep us in your sights.